Okay, hi everyone, SmithyQ, SmithyQ.com. It's Longplay game number 11. In this one, I'm extremely disappointed with myself. I played the second half of this game about as terrible as I can play. I don't know what my excuse is. Well, let's take a look. So, the nice thing is that we get to see the King's Indian in action. So again, I've been slowly trying to learn this, and I tried it in a long play game. And we got the four pawn attack here. And so I'll just do two more moves. So the idea with the four pawn attack, well, as the name suggests, you're attacking with all the pawns, right? And so white typically wants to get this e5 break in. That's pretty much a measure of how white is doing. If white can get e5 in, and he can do it successfully, with no downsides, there's no counterattack, there's no anything else, then in general, white's better. Or at the very least, he's got the initiative, right? And so our task should be to refute or somehow prevent, discourage e5 from happening. So the main line, as far as I know, is c5. He pushes forward. And so already we can see that it's a minor victory in the sense that with the pawn here, and then it goes to d5, but no longer supports the e5 push. So that's a small victory. Then after e6, this is all very standard. Take, take. And so we've reached a very typical structure. I believe this is something you'd find in the Benoni as well, in which black has the pawns on c5 and d6 with the open e-file, as opposed to what's normal, in the King's Indian, is you'd have pawns on e5 and d6. Now, if we back up, I'm fairly certain one of the main lines here is e5 right away, with the idea that we do, white doesn't want to take with something like this, because now all of a sudden his center just completely falls apart. We can see that he's at least two moves away from castling. We can imagine something like knight takes and queen comes over with check, or we can imagine the open e-file suddenly causing bad news bears happening, and white is in trouble. If he takes with the pawn, right, we take back with the pawn, same thing, doesn't want to take with the knight. Taking the pawn doesn't really help either, because after queen takes, let's say he takes with the knight, we can then either take like this, that's not very good, or if he goes here, we're going to win back the pawn at the very least with a really nice position. So e5 is one of those moves to play. I think what white does is supposed to do something like take, take, and then you only play d5. And white tries to get a space advantage. He still has the open f-file, so he's going to get the rook over here, right? Maybe play bishop g5. And it's a position. But by playing e5 right away, we stop white from ever getting a chance to play e5 himself. That's the idea. When we play c5, and we reach this structure, it's a little bit different, in that white always has the possibility of e5, and I always have to watch for that. And that's partly why I play this bishop g4, with the idea that I'm going to exchange his knight, because then the knight can no longer help with the e5 push. Without this knight, again, it's very... Whoops, yeah, okay. If that knight does... And we'll see that in a couple moves. Castle, rook e8. Again, all my play is designed around discouraging this e5 break. Queen c2. Knight b to d7, so again, another piece. Everything is just eyeing towards the e5 break. Then after h3, take, take, and I'm perfectly happy right now. e5 is very well defended. I've got three pieces, and he only has one pawn trying to support it. At any time, I could move this knight. It doesn't have a great square right now. In a perfect world, I'm going to move this knight somewhere. Let's say here. I move this knight back, and then that would include the bishop and the knight. And e5 is just not possible. Here, I played queen a5, which worked out. I'm not sure. I might have to look at this position a bit deeper afterwards. What's the idea with queen a5 first? The idea with queen a5 is I want to play b5, so the queen supports b5, then I can either play b4 or c4, and I'm going to be generally doing things on the queen side. And we can see that, is that, okay, he's got this central pawn wedge, so he probably wants to break through the center. I'm currently stopping that. My pawns, they're aiming over here, my bishop's aiming over here, more or less. You can imagine I drew a good arrow there. And so I'm trying to play on the queen side. And so I'm thinking sort of Benko Gambit-ish. Again, b5, get c4, bring the knight to c5, other knight can come to d7, and I've got a pretty harmonious position, and I could whack away, and he still doesn't have much in the way of anything in the center. That said, I'm not sure what best play really is here. This is about the limit of my knowledge, so I'm going to look at this a little bit deeper. I wasn't completely thrilled with how obvious my play would be, or, yeah, let's put it that way. So, more research is needed. Again, this is a brand new opening for me, and so both the opening, the middle games, even the end games, maybe especially the end games, require, you know, some learning. Anyway, queen a5. He then plays bishop d2, which is a really common move, but the thing is, after I play b5, there's no good discoveries with this knight. Like, the knight can't go anywhere, like he can't take b5, I'll just take with my queen. So he wants to be able to move this knight and open up the bishop to my queen, but there's nothing really good here. And so what does he do? I don't know. He ends up playing knight e2, I just move my queen out of the way, and then he moves his knight all the way over here. I'm guessing the only thing I can think about is he tries to play f5. But if he plays f5, that just leaves a gaping hole here, which my knight can jump in, and then this knight can come back, and oh my goodness, the dark squares are so incredibly weak. And the knight is also potentially able to get kicked back by an h5, h4 advance, which we'll see later in the game. That said, it does support f5, and if I play h5, then the squares might be weak, so it's something I've got to evaluate properly before I do. I can't just play h5 willy-nilly. As it is, I finish my development, so I bring my rook over, it faces his queen, he moves his king out of the way of check, and I just gotta figure out what the best way for my pieces is. And again, I would really like to move this knight to allow the bishop to come out, and I really want to play on the queen side. And so after a bit of thinking, I end up playing c4, and this does a couple things. Well, for one, again, it's just I'm gaining queenside space. That's always great. My queen controls this square, so we can never play bishop b3. Again, a perfect square, knight c5 to d3. That could be very good. Other knight can come back here, where again, I'm always watching e5. And I'm just going to slowly, maybe even not that slowly, push forward this way, see what happens. My opponent plays rook to e1. Again, he's trying to get e5 to work, but it's just, it's not there. I've got too many pieces covering it. Knight c5, and now here the question is, does e5 work here? This is what I spent the last few moves calculating. But it doesn't. We can simply imagine take, take, and then knight f to d7. And we can see here is that the center, it's only defended by one piece, just absolutely collapsing. And after something like e6, take, take, and then, you know, I can just bring the knight, say, to e5. Knight's protected. Pawn is going to be taken. And there's absolutely no worries. In fact, this is not knight. Okay, I'm not. The one potential worry is bishop d5 with a pin afterwards. So, for instance, if I did something like this, right, that could be quite not good. But again, I just need to prepare that, and things are going to be fine. So again, as always, there's no e5, so there's no problem. He plays bishop e3, pinning the knight, that's fine. I go back with my knight d7, everything according to plan. He plays bishop g4. And we can see this. I think the last video I made, I mentioned the space left behind, or what is the disadvantage of your move? When my knight is here, it's pressuring e4, it's pressuring g4, and maybe it can go to h5, right? When I move the knight, well then, all those squares, there's less pressure, and he's able to play bishop g4, which is annoying in the sense that, again, my knight is now pinned, and this knight is also pinned. What do I do? I actually completely miscalculate this. I play queen c7, and then he played b3, and I took his rook. So I think we both kind of had mirages around here. Let's look at my mistake first. Queen c7. What's the problem of this? The problem is that after bishop takes c5, well, what do? If I take with the queen, whoops, I lose a piece. That's not very good. If I take with the pawn, well, all of a sudden, e5, and oh my goodness, e5 is coming with, oh my, those pawns are absolutely crushing. White has everything he wants in this position, and I have no counterplay at all. I'm just sitting here doing absolutely nothing. And so the best move, unfortunately, would be knight takes c5, where I lose the exchange. The one good side is that I'm left with a very good bishop on a very open diagonal. His knight is out of play, it's out of the game, and white actually has no real good play at this moment, and I still can potentially do stuff on the queen side. Computer says the position is about equal, but black was doing better before, so there's no reason for me to do this. And this is a pure miscalculation. I did not... There was something about this, the way the knights, defend each other, and the way the queen defends each other, and I move my queen away from one pin. The illusion of everything being defended was so incredibly strong, I did not evaluate bishop takes c5 enough to notice that none of the moves I want to take actually work. So a better move would be to play queen to d8. Just that way now, after bishop takes c5, I take with the rook. Now the knight's not pinned anymore. I still control this square. Maybe the queen can slide over here. And things are doing fine. Things are doing very well, actually. Again, black still has a fairly comfortable advantage. Queen side play is still coming. Yay. So again, I made a mistake when I played this. My opponent made a bigger mistake. He was so worried about knight coming into d3, I think. He tried to undermine that, and I'm able to just win a rook. So spoiler alert, I do lose this game. Ridiculous, eh? Now, to be fair, white does have some compensation in the fact that I'm missing this dark square bishop, and this diagonal, again, it's wide open. Maybe there's something that can happen all the way down here. At the same time, objectively, white has nothing in this position. I ended up playing h5. Now, this is a good series of moves I did. I played h5, then I played h4, and then I'm not very accurate again. So just why this is so good is after h5, he either needs to exchange the bishop or retreat. He retreats. Then after h4... the knight has no good squares forward, it has to retreat. And so I've been able to push white back significantly, and now e4 is hanging. Now, I kind of miss this. I take the pawn, and then I... Okay, so taking the pawn was the right idea, but then I played knight f6, thinking, okay, good, I'm going to bang up on e5, not realizing that I had already ganged up on... on e4. That I had already ganged up on e4, and I could have simply taken it. If he takes with this guy, I take the queen. And things are absolutely excellent. He can't take this pawn because the knight's going to hang. That's not very good. And so I'm just simply, again, I got the queens off. There's absolutely no danger for me. If he exchanges queens first, that's absolutely fine because everything is still protected. And in fact, it's like he's losing a piece. So that's not very good either. So I could have taken e4 right away. By playing knight f6, that gave him the chance of playing e5, which is still pretty good for me, because after take, things are all right, so maybe he could get away with... Peter wants to play queen c1, and the position is a bit messy, but again, black's still doing very, very well. He ends up playing knight d4, which lets me just take the pawn. And so, It's hard to believe either of us are 2000, 1900 right now, eh? Just a ridiculous series of moves. And I'm going to show how low my rating should be pretty much starting now. Because we exchanged queens, and here is probably the main mistake in the game for me, is that we exchanged queens, and I immediately relaxed. This is exactly what happened, is the queens are off, I'm not going to get checkmated on the diagonal anymore, there's no queens, I'm safe. Literally my thought process, the game is now in the bag, I just have to put it in. And I shouldn't think like this, I tell myself not to think like this, I tell other people not to do this, but it happened. I exchanged queens, and I relaxed. It didn't help that he then plays bishop g1, which is like, what the hell is this? And it's at this point I stop calculating. Or I'm, like, calculating one ply deeply. It's just yuck. Unbelievable. So, I ended up playing knight takes d5, because it was a free pawn. Not noticing that that pawn was also hanging. So, mistake number one, just not counting, not noticing what pieces are hanging, what pieces aren't hanging. I then bring my knight over to b7, which, now how long did I spend? I spent a minute on this move, and again, a complete miscalculation. Now, I was thinking that he's going to try bishop takes with the idea that if I take this, he's got a fork. But I wouldn't take the bishop. I would instead take the knight, because now everything is great, he can't take here, and everything's going to win this pawn, but that's fine. It doesn't matter at all. I could just double up on the back rank, and he's, like, easy position. I can gang up on this pawn, he can't defend it, easy position, and I'm just doing great. So the only move I looked at here was bishop takes, d5, not noticing that he had knight takes d6, knight takes d6, bishop takes. And look what this does. For one, it won him a pawn. Excellent. This pawn is still being attacked by two pieces. It's going to be very hard for me to defend. He's probably going to win that pawn. And also, this pawn, which I was really thinking about winning, is now fully defended. This bishop's position, when it suddenly showed up on d5, it surprised me. And so I played rook to b5, chasing the bishop away so I could win the pawn on b3. And it took me about a quarter of a second after I made my move to see white's reply. I'm sure you see it as well. He simply has the fork. Take, 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 take. And so, through a completely disastrous, seven moves after exchanging queens, in a completely winning, like, again, this position is completely winning, unbelievably winning. I can simply play b4 here. So now the pawn's not hanging, d5 is a threat, how does he stop it? I don't know. This pawn is protected. He'll have to move this knight to do something. If he tries to play it here, I'm just going to come in. And there's actually a lot of threats here, in addition to being up material. I can also gang up on this pawn. And things are just doing very, very well for me. In fact, just normal moves do really well. I can let him take a pawn. I'm up in the exchange. I could try and plant my knight. There's so much I could have done. But then I took a pawn without thinking about what his reply was. I then played knight b7, which allowed him to win another pawn. Playing this move is better because it stops the knight taking, and everything else is still defended. I can then move the knight here with check. Next move, there's no pins, there's nothing he can do. Then when he got to this position, I played far too quickly. Again, not saying, what is my opponent's threat? And again, this is a one-mover. This isn't, you know, this is absolutely, how long did I spend on this move? Less than 10 seconds. And it shows, right? I need to take a deep breath at this point. In fact, that's what I should have done. I should have walked away for a minute. I should have gone to the bathroom or something. Come back, drawn the game. Because this position should be a draw. The reason for that is all the pawns are on the same side of the board. His king isn't very active. It's really hard to create a pass pawn. And with all the pawns on the same side of the board, that tends to favor the knight. Or more accurately, if there's pawns here and there's pawns here, the bishop can often do very well because the bishop can much more easily go from one side of the board to the other and influence it. Well, a knight is limited to just the one side. From here, I can, with all the pawns on one side, things should be okay. I ended up bringing my rook, and then, again, I'm getting scared a little bit about phantoms. My original idea was to play knight f6. But all of a sudden, I realize this looks really scary after check, all right? If I go here, well then, bishop d4, and there's a pin, and it's really hard for me to get out of this. In fact, what the heck do I do? I guess I would try something. I want to put my rook on b6 to defend the knight. If I don't do anything, I just do a waiting move, right? Oh, I'm sorry. No, he'll play bishop e5 first. All right, let's say I do nothing. He can then go here, and there's no stopping this, right? So I got to defend that rank. And it's also, it's scary because there's a very well-known mating threat here. For instance, if I were to go here, bishop to d4. Oh, crap. If I move my knight, that's mate. If I can't defend the knight, oh, crap. And so that means I'd be forced to play this incredibly ugly move. The computer says I'm still doing okay here. It's probably a draw, but I'm going to lose this position. My knight is terrible. His bishop's amazing. I'm almost being checkmated. Again, on this long diagonal, as soon as I thought I relaxed, it was all over, right? So I come all the way back to b8, and I'm just going to sit on the back rank and not let him do anything. That was the idea. He then plays bishop f2, I go to g7, he takes the pawn, but even that doesn't really matter. Okay, he's up a pawn, that's not very good, but the position is so fortress-like, it's really hard to make progress. And I could have shown you if I played better. I bring the knight here. He now sets up a very easy threat to stop. He wants to play this with the skewer. I, of course, go here. He moves the bishop back. I attack the bishop again. He comes out. I attack it. We're just moving around. And it's right here where I mess up. Because you see how he moves? Again, he moves his bishop back to g1. And in my head, I'm thinking, aha, another mistake. The bishop doesn't belong there. The bishop belongs in the middle of the board. Right? He wants to somehow, again, in a perfect world, he wants to put the bishop on the long diagonal. So, some combination of moves like this. And once the bishop can then get on e5, everything, his bishop's actually doing something, right? Here I have an instant draw, if I want it. I can go with g3, h2, and it's just a perpetual check. That'd be a draw, and that makes sense. It's an even game. And I shouldn't really be pushing for a win here. But I do, because I see now that he can't defend this pawn. So I play knight h4, expecting him to play g3. But I can now come in with knight f3. And all of a sudden, things could be really scary for him. If this bishop ever moves, that's mate. If he's not careful, I can go to the back rank, and he can't defend the bishop. Ooh. And if I'm, this is probably the best move. This should be a drawn position as well. This is a 3v2 rook endgame where his king is completely out of play. And this should be a relatively easy fortress, or as easy as any rook and pawn endgame is when you're down a pawn. Right? I should be able to hold this. The problem is that by moving the knight, when my knight was here, it controlled the d4 square. So as soon as I move my knight, he's able to go on the long diagonal, and oh crap, where do I go? I went to f8, which loses instantly, whoops. See, if I go to h7, all of a sudden, we got that mate threat, and I'd be forced to give up the pawn. Now I'm down two pawns. I'm pretty sure this is just losing. Okay, maybe I can win this back. But no, it's... this felt very, very risky. And the computer says it's almost plus three for white. So that's correct. If I were to try and go to h6, exact same thing. However, we could actually go with bishop f6 first. And then, okay, knight moves somewhere. Rook a8. That's going to be, looks like that's mate. Crap. Relatively best is rook h7. King h7. Now, again, he can either win the pawn, which is another pawn. That's great. Or we could go down with familiar threat. Didn't we already look at this? Yeah. So, not good. When I went to f8, this move, look at this. It hits the knight, and it's also stopping my king from escaping. So this is mate. I bring the rook back. He takes the knight. And I don't resign right away. I play a couple moves just to see how he's going to, can he actually beat me? And it took him a while. But, okay, so in the end, I lost to a fork, right? But it took him, eventually he was able to get the bishop to the line diagonal, flushes my king out, and then he was going to win. So a very, very disappointing game. This should have been my first win in a long play game with the King's Indian. I don't want to say I played great up until here, right? Because really what happened is we played normalish moves. I probably had the better position. And then he blundered a rook. Or the exchange, I suppose. Now what's funny is that the computer says that these moves are all... okay, I should have taken the pawn right away. These moves are very, very good. Right? Like near top choice or top choice. And this position is actually... four pawn evaluation in favor of black, right? Completely winning. And the reason I lost this game is because, again, I exchanged queens and I relaxed. I stopped thinking, I stopped calculating, and I blew the game. And I don't really know what to say about that. It's discouraging. Yeah, I'm putting all this time into my tactical training, and I can't even see one move ahead. Anyway, that's that. So, again, not the greatest game ever. It does show the importance of psychology, though. Normally, I'm pretty even keel, right? But once I relaxed, and then once I let those blunders come in, I couldn't stop. And that's something I'll have to fix, something I'll have to take a deep breath next time. Anyway, that's that. So thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. If you want to like or subscribe, that's fine. Yeah, that's it. So that's the SmithyQ for SmithyQ.com. Have a great weekend, everyone. Bye for now.